Capital on a day in September just over 1 year ago. They're in RFK Stadium for Soccer Bowl 80. There to watch the immensely gifted Giorgio Canalia and his New York Cosmos teammates battle for the North American Soccer League Championship. Giorgio Canalia, most prolific scoring machine this league has ever seen. He scored twice as the Cosmos won the title. And they are back again today, pursuing their fifth league championship and their fourth of the past 5 years. And Canalia is not alone. He's joined by some of the great names in the sport, Niskins and Bogisevich and Ricebergen, and young Americans like Jeff Durkin and Ricky Davis. But the Cosmos will be tested by a hungry and skillful team from Chicago. Last Monday night, a bitterly contested series against San Diego came down to the shootout. It was tied 2-2 for this shot. Franz Matthew, one-on-one against Volkmar Gross in the shootout. The Sting defender cut to his right and gently pushed the ball beyond the distraught San Diego goalkeeper, and nearly 40,000 exuberant Chicagoans went quietly crazy in Comiskey Park. The Sting was in the Soccer Bowl at last. Chicago is a city thirsting after a winner, and this could be the day a title is delivered as Franz Matthew and the Sting make their first appearance ever in the championship match. It's the high-scoring Sting of Chicago against Giorgio Canalia and the equally high-scoring defending champion Cosmos of New York in Soccer Bowl 81. ABC Sports presents Soccer Bowl 81. It's the New York Cosmos versus the Chicago Sting from Exhibition Stadium in Toronto, Ontario, Canada. This ABC Sports exclusive is brought to you by Light Beer. Everything you always wanted in a beer and less. The Sting of Chicago and the Cosmos of New York meeting here in neutral territory in Toronto at Exhibition Stadium for Soccer Bowl 81. A crowd better than 40,000 expected to fill the stands before the two teams kick off. We have overcast skies and a threat of rain hanging above Toronto. It has held off through much of the day, and really the temperatures are quite comfortable at around 65 degrees. Hi, everybody. I'm Vern Lundquist, here to call the play-by-play for you tonight as Chicago takes on New York in Soccer Bowl 81. 15 teams qualified for the playoffs this year in the NASL. New York is the highest scoring team in the league, drew a bye in the first round of the playoffs. Chicago had to play three series to get to this point. Let's see what Chicago has accomplished to make it to Toronto so far. In the first round, they took on the Seattle Sounders and defeated them in three games, winning two at home, losing on the road. Next, against Montreal, they lost in Montreal before nearly 60,000, then won back-to-back games at home, 4-2, 4-2, and finally, they went out to San Diego, lost the first game, came back to Chicago, won the middle game 2-1, and then in the shootout, defeated the Suckers 1-0 to advance to the championship match for the first time. As we said, the Cosmos drew a bye in the first round and then went down to Tampa Bay in the second round of the playoffs, defeated Tampa Bay 6-3, came back and lost at home, a rarity at the Meadowlands, 2-3 in the shootout, and defeated Tampa 2-0. Then finally they defeated Fort Lauderdale 4-3 in Fort Lauderdale in the first game, and they swept the series by winning and going through at home by a count of 4-1. Now the starting lineups, first of all for the Chicago Sting and their head coach, Willie Roy. Again, they are making their first appearance here. Dieter Ferner will start in goal. Derek Spalding at right back, his fourth year in the NASL. Also on the back line for the Sting, defender Paul Hahn, a midseason acquisition. Franz Matthew, who will be marking Giorgio Canalia tonight. And on the left side, Dave Husson. At midfield, Ingo Peter. Rudy Glenn, a young American from Indiana University, and Charlie Ficus, a fellow student at Indiana University. Up front, Arno Steffenhagen, first-teamer in the NASL this year. The talented Karl-Heinz Granica, fourth year in the NASL, and 21-year-old Pato Marhedic, the head coach, is Willie Roy. The Cosmos have had their problems with the Chicago Sting. They have defeated them only once since 1976. They will start in goal tonight, Hubert Birkenmeyer, who is in his third year with the Cosmos. At right back, Andronic Eskandarian. He'll be joined on that back line by Bob Yarushi, young Canadian. Also in the back line, the young American Jeff Durkin, his second year as a pro. And Wim Ricebergen, perhaps the most talented defender in the league. In midfield, a great one, Johan Niskins. Ivan Buljan from Yugoslavia. And fellow Yugoslav, Vladislav Bogisevich. And up front, we'll have Seninho, the very, very fast winger. In the middle, Giorgio Canalia. And they will be joined by Steve Wegerle, another off-season acquisition of the Cosmos, and the head coach, Hennis Weisweiler. There are the Cosmos and the Chicago Sting as we prepare for Soccer Bowl 81. The Cosmos, of course, have been in this match 5 to 4 times previously, and you'll notice that they have never lost. They won it in 80, they won it in 78, 77, and they also won it years back in 1972. The Cosmos and Chicago Sting, great crowd. Ought to be a dandy. We'll be back right after this from Exhibition Stadium in Toronto. We have the Sting of Chicago against the Cosmos of New York for the championship of the North American Soccer League today. A lot of folks have made their way up from Chicago, and an equal amount have come from New York to watch this match. Our expert on the sport for Soccer Bowl 81, as he was in Soccer Bowl 80 and Soccer Bowl 79, is Paul Gardner, good friend, a fine journalist and author. Paul, really an interesting contrast in the personalities of the two men who coach these squads.
Yes, Willie Roy for Chicago. He calls himself a self-made coach, and that's not a bad description, because really he's won no major titles yet. He was a player in this league many years ago. I'm old enough to remember that, in fact. He was Rookie of the Year once, and he got this coaching job because the previous coach didn't do very well. In came Willie Roy, and he's been there ever since 1978. He's a great favorite in Chicago. Hennis Weisweiler, on the other hand, one of the world's great coaches, of course. He's won more titles than he can possibly remember, but he has been having his trouble this year with the New York fans. He's not been popular, and the rumors have swirled around really half the season that this man is on his way out, and there's a very strong rumor here today that this could be his last game for the Cosmos. But I don't think I want to dwell on the coaches for this game, because we've got such talented players on the field, and I'm hoping that this will be a game after my own heart, where it's the players who shape and pattern and structure this game, really regardless of what the coaches are yelling and screaming from the sidelines. Take a look at some of those players. Pato Marhedic from Argentina, only 21 years old, but what a dribbler. He gives the Cosmos so many problems. They'll really have to watch out. They'll put Escandarian on him, but it's not going to be easy to stop Marhedic. Arno Steffenhagen, the same sort of thing, a European player, marvelous finishing as well. He's a threat to score goals and to cause problems in the defense for other players. And of course, Karl-Heinz Granitza, we all know about his scoring capabilities. But you can turn this round. You can take a look at the Cosmos. Giorgio Canaglia, well, there isn't a better scorer around in this league than Giorgio Canaglia. And two marvelous wingers, Steve Wegerle from South Africa, who they acquired in mid-season. Fast, and again, a threat to cut inside and score. And Seninho, probably be the fastest player on the field here this evening, who represents, I would say, if the footing is firm out there, probably the biggest threat to Chicago. But if there's one man I have to pick out as being perhaps the key to this game, it would have to be Karl-Heinz Granitza, because I think the Cosmos are a little afraid of him. The reason I say that is because he's burned them badly in previous games. In the 3-2 game, watch this goal. This was the final goal. Free kick over the wall. Nobody can touch it. Birkenmeier, what can you do about that? Not very much, I'm afraid. He's lethal on those, and that is why the Cosmos have been saying aloud to the press, hey, all these free kicks that Karl-Heinz Granitza is getting is falling down. He doesn't deserve those free kicks, because they don't want to give away free kicks outside the penalty area. And that's why I think they're going to be very, very careful, particularly in marking players like Marhedic. No free kicks just outside the area.
That was a 3-2 Chicago victory in New York. Now, the two teams had a rematch at midsummer. It took place at Wrigley Field in Chicago. Better than 30,000 were on hand, and it was as wild and woolly and crazy a game as we have seen in the North American Soccer League. It wound up 6-5 in the shootout. Here's the first goal. In goal, Peter. That made it 1-0 Chicago, 9th minute. 25th minute, Dave Husson, 2-0 Chicago. 28th minute, Giorgio Canaglia, 2-1 Chicago, still has the lead. Romero for New York. That tied it up 2-2 just before halftime. Charlie Ficus gives Chicago a 3-2 lead. Second half, Arno Steffenhagen. It's 4-2 Chicago. 70th minute, Giorgio Canaglia, 4-3 Chicago. 75th minute, Romero to tie at 4-4. Then Ingo Peter makes it 5-4 Chicago, and with 40 seconds left, Ivan Bullion ties it up 5-5. The crowd went crazy, and Chicago wound up winning it by a count of 6-5. That's a prelude of things to come. We hope we have that kind of exciting match for you tonight. We'll be back to continue our preview of Soccer Bowl 81. The Chicago Sting and the New York Cosmos just moments away from the start of Soccer Bowl 81. And there are a couple of extraordinarily intriguing matchups in this game today. For Chicago, the high-scoring Karl-Heinz Granitza will be marked by young American Jeff Durgan. And Giorgio Canaglia, the highest scoring player in the league, will be marked by Franz Mathieu. I had a chance to chat with each of those four men about these matchups, and I asked Karl-Heinz Granitza how he would beat Jeff Durgan.
just help from other teammates, from my team. That is enough. I cannot beat him all the times, one against one. I need help from other players from our team.
Does he have a weakness, though, that you can exploit, that you've discovered in your previous encounter?
Yeah, maybe everybody expect Granitsev just a left foot or just a free kick. I can score him with a head ball. I can score him with the right foot. Maybe I try this today.
We might see you going to the right then, huh?
Today I'm going maybe more times to the right than everybody expect.
Good luck, Carl.
Thank you. It's very nice.
Jeff, obviously, the power is in the left foot. Do you overcompensate when you play him, watching that left foot?
No, I don't think you can really do that with a professional player like this because, sure, he favors his left foot, but if I just try to mark the left leg, he's going to turn around and play it with his right. He is that good. Anybody, you know, with that kind of a shot in his left foot, he's still going to be able to hit the ball with the right. Maybe not as accurately and not as strong, but he can still hit it. So I've just got to play him fair and try to not let him turn with that left.
Yeah, that Kinnock guy is a good player, very smart, you know, very sneaky too. You know, you have to be careful when you play against him because if you made mistake, he's always there. You know, anything you made wrong, he's always there to score. You know, that's the big point. You know.
And you know, I've seen it so many times. I know you have too. You keep him quiet for 86 minutes, and then in the 87th, boom, it's in the net.
No, tomorrow I don't think it will be like that.
You don't?
No, I don't think so.
You plan to shut him out?
Yeah, not, but I think I will play a good game tomorrow against him. You know, if I have to play against him, I think it will be good, and I don't think he will score.
There is, of course, an excellent chance that Franz Matthew will be marking you.
Yes.
How good is he?
He's very quick. And, you know, I don't like quick people because it makes my life more difficult. But in the previous two games, I scored 3 goals against him. So, you know, I'm doing something right. But it's not just one player that they have. You know, usually when Matthew goes up, they keep somebody else back on me. So it's always one guy always has to keep an eye constantly on me.
Interesting. He told us that he thinks he's going to be able to shut you out in the game.
For him, I hope he does. You know, for me, I hope he doesn't. I think that it's not going to be easy for me, and it's not going to be easy for him.
Giorgio Canaia, and the game is underway. Chicago wins it, and Arno Steffenhagen goes forward, taken away from Ingo Peter Bogisevich, and Johan Niskens goes back. There's a chase for the ball. Marhedic trying to get it. And they send it back to Hubert Birkenmeier.
Uncharacteristic error by Niskens to start off the game there. A little bit of nerves, maybe there, an easy ball to control. A pass from his own teammate, in fact, that he let get past him.
Canaglia at midfield sends it forward looking for Steve Wegerle, but it's taken away by the Sting. Now at midfield, Bogey has it once again. Opening moments of the game, Chicago and New York. The Sting in the final for the first time. Wegerle on the left side. Wegerle, former high-scoring winger for Tampa Bay, was sent to Los Angeles, then acquired by the Cosmos early in the year. Niskens at midfield. Now Bouillon, long pass right side, too far, and it's over the sideline. It'll be throw in Chicago.
Yeah, well, we remarked on Cenino's speed, but that pass from Durgan was a little bit optimistic. I don't think he can run that fast. And of course, we got to recall too that this field is a bit damp. The ball is likely to speed off it. If it bounces, it's likely to go off very quickly.
Marhedic, who has been hampered by a pulled hamstring throughout the year. You can see he's still got that left thigh bandaged.
No, they're giving him much too much room back there. That can cause a problem. A lot of problems if they allow him to run with the ball. When he passed it, he gave it away. But if he kept running, I think it would cause more problems.
Bogisevich forward to Canaglia. Back on the right side. Now over to the right side. Cenino. They're looking for Canaglia. It's too high and too far. It'll come across the near sideline and result in the second Chicago throw-in.
An example of the sort of thing that Cenino can do. When he got that ball, I think I and probably everybody else expected him to speed outside Derek Sporting and use his speed. In fact, he hardly moved at all. He did a little jinking of his body and then put over a cross. Alas, for the Cosmos, far too hard. Went over everybody.
43 minutes remaining first half. No score, no threat thus far. Ball played forward. There's Granica with the header, and Birkenmeier comes out, makes a relatively easy save.
Yeah, Birkenmeier is always very quick to see those. He'll be off his line very quickly. It's going to be very difficult for any forward to get in on those before Birkenmeier.
This is Ingo Peter. Another mid-season acquisition by the... Oops! And that may be the first evidence we've had of the fact that rain has fallen here. Looked like a slip.
Yes, a straightforward slip by Karl-Heinz Granica. Look at the speed of Cenino here.
That's Paul Hahn.
Yeah, Paul Hahn playing the sweeper role and doing it to perfection there, reading that, seeing that the fullback was going to be beaten by Cenino's speed, getting there first.
Steppenhagen at midfield. Bouillon with a near takeaway. There's Yarushi, kicks it across the far sideline. Another throw in for the Chicago Stake. No score in the game. Chicago and New York. How much, Paul, does the experience of having played in the championship match relate to this game for the Cosmos and the Stakes?
You know, I never know how to answer that question because, I mean, you can give the obvious answer and say if you've played in two or three championship games, you're gonna treat it all as experience and you're gonna be very cool about it. But I'm not sure that necessarily helps. I just don't know how to answer it. I really don't. I think Chicago are up for this game. I think the Cosmos are up for it. There's going to be a little bit of nerves on both sides. The first evidence we saw of nerves was from Naiskins, who has to be one of the most experienced players on the field.
This is Paul Hahn going back to his goalkeeper, Dieter Ferner. Yet one more midseason acquisition. He was the latest acquisition by the Chicago Sting in their stretch drive. Actually, that was not a stretch acquisition. It was in the middle of the year. Ingo Peter trying to get there. Naiskins takes it away for the Cosmos.
Typical bit of Naiskins, throwing himself at the ball. Durgan getting, you see, this is the danger of Marhedic.
Marhedic left of the goal. Birkenmeyer scoops it up, distributes out to the right side.
That was really an interesting little confrontation there because Durgan is such a big boy and Marhedic is so slender and slight, and yet the two in a slight physical contact there, and it's Durgan who goes down and it's Marhedic who comes away with the ball.
Here's Jeff Durgan. He'll be in the spotlight tonight trying to keep Karl-Heinz Granitza silent through most of the match. Wegerle. Hahn with the takeaway. Nice steal by Paul Hahn. Here's Derek Spalding. Midfield now to Charlie Fikas. Over to Ingo Peter as the Sting mounts an attack. The buildup beginning. Long booming shot. What a thrust and a blast by Ingo Peter. No score in the match. 40 minutes remaining in the first half. And that's the first serious attack on goal we have had. Ingo Peter scored one like that against Montreal in the playoffs.
Yes, and he scored not quite so far out as that, but it's certainly a booming shot against the Cosmos earlier in the season. That must have been all of 40 yards, and it wasn't more than a yard or two over the bar.
Rudy Glenn. Bouillon almost got it. Now Peter has it back for Chicago. Nice steal by Naiskins again. He's down on the ground.
At full length again.
This is Wegerle. Riarushi, right side for Sonino. Taken away by Derek Spalding.
Well, very nicely cut out by Derek Spalding. Unfortunately, he couldn't quite get to it before it ran over the sideline there, but that was a good interception because Sonino was off and running down that wing.
Got a good look at the recently naturalized U.S. citizen. He's a Scotsman, Derek Spalding, that is. Now the Cosmos. They are the home team, despite the fact that, yes, they are wearing their home uniforms. Now Chicago, Paul Hahn. He's 6'2", 32-year-old defender. Canaya trying to get the takeaway unsuccessfully. No foul called. Our referee tonight is Dante Moglio. A junior linesman is Robert Donahue. A senior linesman is Derek Davis. This is Moglio's first Soccer Bowl refereeing assignment. There was a foul called. It'll be a free kick for Chicago. And Granitza will let it go, and Hahn will take it.
Now, I don't think Granitza is going to score anything from that far out, but within about 25 yards of the goal, yes.
That should result in a goal kick for the Cosmos of New York. It does. We are scoreless with 38 minutes remaining in the first half. Resembling an attack, they have not really approached the goal mouth yet. And there is a chest trap. Paul Hahn once again for the Sting. Battle for it up in the air, and the battle is won by the Sting, and there's a foul called.
That's interesting. We've had two fouls called over there within the last 2 minutes, and they've both been against Eskandarian. A little bit too boisterous in his play there, I think, Eskandarian. He is prone to foul, and as I say, it might be a problem with Marhedic.
Franz Matthew across the midfield stripe. Out on the right side they go. Husson has it taken away, and here's the chase for the ball that Wegerle does not quite win. Nice sliding tackle by Rudy Glenn.
Good run by Rudy Glenn. The referee has given that throw into the Cosmos, which is obviously not right because it clearly went off Wegerle's legs, but the Cosmos are going to worry about that. Here's Bouillon.
And out to take it in the air is Dieter Ferner. Quick distribution left side. In goal, Peter.
Long swirling cross from Bullion, looking for the head of Canalia. And incidentally, we must not underrate the heading ability of Giorgio Canalia. You tend to think of him as scoring goals with his feet. But Canalia, in fact, for short, sharp, decisive headers, is a very good header of the ball indeed.
37 minutes remaining in the first half. Chicago and New York in Soccer Bowl 81 from Toronto. Hahn to Granitza, left-footed shot deflected by the Cosmos.
An example of Granitza's firepower there, because there was no wind-up on that shot at all. He just seemed to cock his leg very slightly and hit it. It bounced off a defender and it bounced back, oh, a good 20 yards.
Once again, Weggerly with plenty of space. Now Peter comes over. Husson at left back. At midfield, Naiskens back in the good graces of the Cosmos coach and management after a year's suspension.
Yep, well, that was one of the examples of Weisweiler's iron-fisted rule, which the fans weren't very happy with. He kept Naiskens off the team for a long time. The fans wanted him back, and they finally got their way. He is back on the team.
Mentioned the Cosmos are the home team. You might be wondering why. That's based on the total points that they accumulated throughout the year. Chicago was the second highest accumulative team in the league. The score is nothing-nothing with 35-54 remaining in the first half. Nice tackle by Franz Mathieu. Now the counterattack.
Watch Mathieu run upfield. He's very fast, Mathieu. My headache again. Now he should take on players, but he's passed the ball.
Ball went through and Birkenmeyer grabs it.
Good move by Mahedic, looking for Steffenhagen cutting in, but, oh, I would think 6 inches, a little too far in front of Steffenhagen. I was rather hoping that Mahedic would do one of two things, which he didn't do, either run through the middle with the ball in his own, or push it out to the right, where Mathieu, who made that sliding tackle, was overlapping on the right, and he's so fast, Mathieu. I'm calling him Mathieu because he told me that's what his name should be, although it's become Matthew in the...
Once again, we have anglicized
in the United States.
That's right. Anglicized the French name.
Not anglicized. I thought Americanized.
Oh, Americanized, I suppose, would be more appropriate. Yes. That from Englishman Paul Gardner. Here's the shot by Granitza. One bouncer. And Birkenmeyer perfectly placed.
Cosmos are obviously going to have to watch these long-range shots because it seems that Chicago are determined to, as soon as they see an opening, to take a shot. And, of course, they've got these two players. They might even add three if you add Steffenhagen. They've got Granitza and they've got Ingo Peter, both of whom can fire in the ball from 25 to 30 yards out.
That's a good look at Hubert Birkenmeyer, 32-year-old goalkeeper. He was a second division goalkeeper in West Germany before being acquired by the Cosmos. It'll be a throw-in for New York and will be taken by Steve Weggerly.
I think they've given a free kick for that. Hewson came in to intercept that ball that was going to Weggerly and raised his leg probably above waist level. And the referee had judged that to be dangerous play. Free kick, Cosmos.
Here's Chicago on the run once again. Down the right side, Husson is forced out.
Bad foul by Urushi. He might get a talking to the referee from that. Yes, he's calling Urushi over. In fact, he's going to give him a yellow card for that early in the game. And I must say that I do agree with that, because obviously Hewson was going to get past Urushi with that ball and he was going to be in the clear, and Urushi made no attempt to play the ball, ran in front of Hewson and sort of pushed him out of the play. Yellow card to Urushi. A warning, if he does it again, he's off the field.
Now Ingo Peter with the free kick, and it's headed out by Steve Weggerly. Canalia almost got there, but Mathieu took it away. Weggerly back, being marked by Peter. Peter with the steal, right wing, now the center. Birkenmeyer, the net is open, but nobody there to take advantage of it.
Birkenmeyer has done this again and again during the season, and particularly in the playoffs. Unquestionably, only Birkenmeyer could prevent a goal there, and Birkenmeyer came up with the key play, because Ingo Peter stole the ball, put across a perfect center, and I think Mahedic or Granitza could have had that ball in the net, but for that almost desperate deflection by Birkenmeyer.
Here's Reisbergen trying to come through. The ball deflected by Sininho.
Pardon my laugh there, but Reisbergen is a player who plays this game at its simple, fundamental best, in my opinion. He's a bit of a rough player. He's a bit clumsy, but when he goes forward, he knows only one way to go and only one way to push the ball, and that's straight at the goal. And sometimes he does it a little too hard, like that one, where he nearly knocks Sininho down with it. But I think his intentions, the directness of his approach, are very much to my liking.
Weggerly has it now for the Cosmos as Hewson had it taken away. Now Hewson kicks it across the sideline. We've got 32 minutes remaining in the first half and we still have no score.
I think we've got a change in what I would have assumed to be the marking assignments. Eskandarian, I think, is not on my headache. We've got Reisbergen on my headache.
as Bob Yerushi. Eskandarian now. And it's across the far touchline. And again, pushed across the far sideline. Really a tremendous crowd here in Toronto for this match. It'll be some time before we get a final crowd count, but excellent and noisy. Chicago and New York, Vern Lundquist and Paul Gardner from Toronto. This is Houston trying to chip it over so Mathieu can get to it, and he does. Now he doesn't keep it in play. It's across the sideline. And we've got 31-47 remaining in the first half. Chicago nothing and New York nothing.
You know,
Bolyan, Yugoslavian, who's a bears a remarkable resemblance to Bogišević.
They look very much alike facially and in terms of body build. The way they move about is not quite the same.
That was Bogišević forward to Steve Wegerle. Now back to Bogey.
The biggest difference is right there. Bogey with his left foot. Bogey, a very left-footed player. Bullion, who you just saw, with his right foot.
Now Sonino. Nice takeaway by Spalding. Sonino gets it back. Good work. Sonino, sliding tackle is, and Niskins has it now for the Cosmos. There's Charlie Fikas, the ball deflected, and Granica has it.
What ended up to be a good pass to Granica. He certainly didn't intend to do that. He just sort of flashed his foot at the ball.
Houston, forward to Fikas. Bullion gets it, and it'll go all the way back to Birkenmeyer and the Cosmos control.
And, of course, a round of boos from this very vociferous crowd. I don't know how many Chicago fans we've got here, but he's certainly got quite a party of them.
Another look at Hubert Birkenmeyer. He really had a brilliant Soccer Bowl 80 a year ago.
Oh, he did. Absolutely.
In the match against Fort Lauderdale. Here's Fikas. Tamar Hedick back to Fikas. Nice little give and go. Now, Charlie Fikas, can he get around the corner? No. As Yerushi makes the steal. Now, Wegerle for the Cosmos.
Charlie Fikas seemed to be in some doubt. He got a perfect return pass from Hedick. He seemed to be in some doubt as to whether he should try and hit it from about 20 yards out or whether he should control it, and of course indecision, he ended up doing neither.
Naiskins playing way up. Now Canalia, one touch, tries to get it back. Bullion slips. There's a bump off the ball, and Bogišević has it for the Cosmos. There's Mathieu, who
I don't know whether we're gonna see too much of that. I can't quite see what Woody Roy's reaction to that was, but a heart attack would have been the most suitable one, I think.
Good look at Bogišević.
Right, now we have a first foul on Granita by Durgan. Durgan raising his hand to acknowledge the foul.
And that's the one thing the Cosmos hope to avoid tonight, is to give that man right there a chance at the direct free kick.
Yeah, I think we're a bit too far out for it to be effective here. This kick is some 30 yards out.
He had a phenomenal success rate.
He's going to try it. And there's some respect. You don't often see a wall of four people set up for a kick 35 yards out.
The left foot of Karl-Heinz Granica. See what he can accomplish.
Crouching on his goal line there. Nice. Ball.
On. Ball is cleared by Durgan. But Chicago will retain possession of it back at the offside mark. Now Hahn. And the buildup begins anew. Going forward to Steffenhagen. Steffenhagen has it deflected. It'll go across the end line. It'll be our first corner kick of the night. Touch last by the Cosmos.
It was so noticeable on that free kick that Birkenmeyer was crouching, tense, leaping up and down his line there, almost as though that were a penalty kick. And don't forget that ball was 35 yards away.
Granica will take the corner with the left foot. It's an outswinger. The header, diving save, Birkenmeyer. Steffenhagen, nice shot.
Steffenhagen, yes, not quite where he would have wanted it. Perfectly taken corner from Granica. A lovely flicked header down to Birkenmeyer's left. But unfortunately, you'll see it goes a little too close to Birkenmeyer. He doesn't really have to move very far to his left to get it. If that ball had been a couple of yards nearer the post, certain goal for Chicago.
Now Bogišević for the Cosmos with 28 minutes to go in the first half. No score in the match. Sonino back to Bogišević. Forward, here's Canalia. And Mathieu is right by his shoulder blades.
An example of what Giorgio said he didn't like, was the swiftness of Mathieu.
Derek Spalding, sliding tackle by Bob Yerushi. And let's look at that corner kick once again, Paul.
We'll take a look at the near goal, if you like, a left-footed, as nearly everything is, with Granica corner kick. Steffenhagen up above everybody, flicks the ball off to his right, and it's dropping onto the goal line. Birkenmeyer down to trap it.
Back to play as it develops on the field now as Wim Reisbergen has the ball for the Cosmos. No score in the match. That is as close as we have come. That corner from Granica, the header by Steffenhagen. Reisbergen. Now Wegerle is in front. Reisbergen will come down the left wing. Bullion. Zaninho on the right side. There's Niskins up front. Nice move by Zaninho. The center looking for Canaya. Mathieu is there to kick it out. But Niskins with the foot trap has the ball once again. Half volley to Bullion. Now the volley shot. Watch out. Here's Dieter Furner. Relatively easy save.
Strange looking play there because Bullion, I can't believe that Bullion thought he was going to score, but oh, what a pass from Mahedic.
Dave Hewson to Rudy Glenn with the long locks flowing, and it goes across the sideline. It'll be a throw-in, and there's a look at Ivan Bullion.
I was saying his shot, which he took from about 20, I can't believe that was a shot, and it flashed into the penalty area, and there suddenly were the sprawling bodies of Mathieu and Canalia. And if Canalia had been able to get his foot firmly on it, then I think Ferner would have had problems knowing exactly where the ball was going.
Johan Niskins. Pace momentarily slowed down now. Here's Reisbergen, left side. Logisevic to Wegerle. Hit from behind by Hewson. It'll be throw in for New York.
Yeah, Hewson in very hard, fairly, mind you, but in very hard and very quickly on Wegerle. He doesn't want to give Wegerle any room at all.
Bullion, Sting has it. Steffenhagen taken away by Ivan Bullion. Was it Phil Mushnick of the New York Post nicknamed him Beef?
Well, he's Beef and Chicken. We've got two versions of him, actually. Very much not Chicken this evening.
Steffenhagen.
See how quickly that the player who tackled him there was Wegerle, very quick to run back from his forward wing position to tackle a Chicago player when he breaks.
I have heard it expressed, Paul, by members, other coaches who are here watching the match, that they feel that New York most fears an early Chicago score.
Well, normally you would say, yes, an early goal is an advantage to a team, but I don't know. There's so many players on this team. Oh, Rudy Glenn pulling at Zaninho. This will be a free kick in the area, of course, which Chicago would love to have one at the other end of the field. This is about 25 yards out.
It's
a good 30 yards out. Canalia, if he takes it, will whack it with firmness. Bogey will push it to him.
There's the deflection, and the ball is wide right. Goal kick for the Chicago Sting. 24 minutes remaining in the first half, no score. Dieter Furner will kick it out now for the Sting with 24-23 remaining in the first half of the match. Any surprises that have developed for you so far?
No, I don't think so. I'm delighted to see that neither team is playing particularly cautiously. When you were talking just now about teams wanting to score or not wanting to give up the first goal, that, of course, is what occasions caution. Teams go out there and they really play very defensively. But this hasn't been the case here. There's been a wide-open game so far with a lot of room in midfield.
Donny Maglio has called the offside, so it'll come the other direction. And the Cosmos will try and get something near the goal mouth. No score from Toronto, Soccer Bowl 81. This will be taken by Hewson of the Sting. Now they try to get to Canalia, and Hans going to let it go through, and Dieter Furner will come out.
Well, France gonna Mathieu let it go through. I don't know whether he intended to let it go through. He seemed to sprawl a bit as he went. As it turned out, it was exactly the right thing to do, because there was much too much pace on the ball for Georgia to catch up with it.
Franz Mathieu, Ingo Peter. I saw that goal he scored against Montreal in the playoffs, and it had to be from 35, 40 yards out.
Yeah, I think it was credited at 45, actually.
Just a terrific blast. Here's Spalding, back to Peter. Inside the penalty box, across the touchline, corner kick.
Bogisevic back there to save what was a rather threatening situation developing there.
Went across the end line, last touch by members of the Cosmos, and so Karl-Heinz Granica will aim it toward the general vicinity of the man you just saw, Hubert Birkenmeier. Outswinger once again, headed out of danger by the Cosmos. Now up to Wegerle, who's gone over to the right side now. Oh, Steve is loose. Now it's a two-on-three situation. The Sting do have defenders back. Wegerle cuts to his left. Comes over to Canalia. Again, Mathieu right there. Nice move by Canalia, but helped out. The Sting is by Paul Hahn.
Yeah, well, again, Hahn doing his sweeping job absolutely to perfection, because that's what the sweeper's there for. When the stopper or one of the fullbacks is beaten, the sweeper should slide across and sweep up the disaster, if you like. Take care of it, and that's exactly what he did.
Wegerle, this one comes across the sideline. It's going to be ruled last touch by Chicago. Bogišević. Vladislav Bogišević. Just a little too far, intended for Bouillon by Steve Wegerle. And here's Charlie Fikas, the young blonde from Chicago. To Karl-Heinz Granica.
Now, there's Granica, who's a center forward like Canali, but playing well back.
Here's Fikas, deflected and taken by Niskins. Now back toward midfield, long pass for Bogišević. Has a man open in the middle. One hopper. But the sting, up, they don't get there. Ingo Peter tried to get it. Back to Bogišević. 21:30 to go in the first half of play. Wim Rijsbergen, veteran star of both the 74 and 78 Dutch national teams in the World Cup.
There's a shot here for Bouillon if he did want to take it, but he wasn't very accurate with it. Again, well, the referee said it was deflected, so I think we're going to have a corner kick. This is the Cosmos' first corner kick, I think, Byrne, isn't it?
It is indeed, and it comes 21 minutes remaining in the first half. Steve Wegerle will take the corner.
And unlike the corner kicks at the other end by Granica, this will be an in-swinger. In other words, there will be curve on the ball, and it'll tend to swerve in towards the goalkeeper rather than away from him.
Canalia, Durgan, and it swung a little too far.
Did I say swerve into it? It did. It swung away from him.
That was
and
even...
it's greeted with a chorus of raucous, derisive boos from the Chicago fans, because really, in top-class soccer, to waste a corner kick like that.
Well, that one took a left hook and it was into the wind.
It was into the Cosmos cheerleaders back there. Really demolished them.
Dave Hewson, who has played at Calgary, California, and picked up at midfield as a free agent by the Sting, over to Franz Mathieu. Boy, he has been all over Canalia so far here in the first half. Here's Derek Spalding, the comedian of the Sting, they say. Just acquired his citizenship here recently. Now Mathieu, plenty of space. Across midfield, looks down the left side, and it's a little bit too much for Rudy Glenn. It'll be a goal kick for the Cosmos. 19:58 to go, no score. Rob Yerushi, who has worn two championship rings, one playing for Toronto here when they won the league title in 76, and the other for the Cosmos.
In fact, he's a native of Toronto, I think.
Went to York University here, yes. Ingo Peter, left side it goes. Charlie Fikas. Fikas, too far. Canalia has it, and he turns and mounts the counterattack, but then kicks it back. Settles it for Johan Niskins.
Well, Canalia again, we saw Granica coming back almost to the halfway line. Now, on that one, we saw Canalia back in his own half of the field to pick up a ball. It's unusual to see these two center forwards playing that far back, particularly Canalia.
Indicative in your mind of what, Paul?
Well, indicative maybe of the fact that Canalia's trying to escape Mathieu, who, as you said, is all over him, but also maybe indicative of a little bit of caution, because when you start pulling players back, it means you're maybe emphasizing their defensive duties a bit more than you should be, or a bit more than I would like, let me say that.
Eskandarian. Ivan Bouillon. Whoops, now you see him slip. As we said, it's been raining for a couple of days. Didn't rain terrifically hard here during the day, and has not rained for about 3 or 4 hours, but the surface still a little slippery. Bob Yerushi, marked by Rudy Glenn, gets it through to Naiskens. He's marked by Charlie Fikas. Now on the right side to Rijsbergen, who's gone over to the right back and kicked across the far touchline. It'll be a throw in for the Cosmos. Wim Rijsbergen, the throw in goes. He tries to find Sininho, but it's taken away by the Sting. We have no score, only one really serious goal scoring threat thus far. That a header by Arno Steffenhagen some 6-7 minutes ago. Down the right side for Hewson, and he is in play. Now, the ball remained in play, so that's a valid ball. Offside is called by the linesman, though, and the referee says play on. Now he's called it. Nope. Says play on. He has the option, of course, of ignoring the linesman.
It's very difficult for the referee, because as soon as the linesman's flag goes up, that's a signal to the referee that somebody is offside somewhere, and it baffles me how the referee is supposed to know where that player is, whether he's concerned with the player or whether he's over on the other side of the field. The normal response of the referee to those flags is to stop play, unfortunately.
Nice bit of work by Bouillon, and a takedown
Arno Steffenhagen got Weggerly down around the ankles and chopped him. So
yeah, there's no question he brought him. That was clearly unintentional, but there was no question he brought him down. And although you're not supposed to call unintentional fouls, I think it's right to call that because Steffenhagen definitely stopped a developing play there.
Canaya quickly over on the right side. Zanino with the center up in the air. It'll be a little too much and headed across the near side by Steffenhagen of Chicago. That will result in yet one more Cosmos throw in. Jeff Durgan, who has pushed up. 20 years of age. Has Houston heading it out of danger momentarily, but Naiskins gets it back to Zanino for the Cosmos. And this guy has speed. Long pass left side for Weggerly, who's open. The header down to Bullion, watch out. And they look for Canaya and find Mathieu instead. Cosmos once again back at midfield. Bullion, Zanino. Now Naiskins is loose and Hahn comes over and takes it away for Chicago. Playing a little game of keep away here so far.
Yeah, well, for the moment, the Cosmos are controlling the ball, obviously. I mean, it seems from the pattern of the game when the Cosmos control the ball that they're going to be much more patient about it. I mean, you could say much more boring about it, if you like, because they're not going so incisively towards the goal as Chicago do when they have the ball.
There's Mathieu, perfectly placed once again. And he'll clear it out to the left side. It'll come across the touchline, and the Cosmos again have a throw-in. But despite the buildup and the number of times they touched the ball, they really haven't penetrated the penalty box yet.
No, they haven't. They're playing, doing not to the extent that I feared they might, but to an extent which puzzles me and disturbs me a bit. They're being a little bit slow and cautious in this buildup.
Jeff Durgan comes way over for Weggerly, who has to go back and get the ball, which he does. Now Marhedic comes over to cover him, and Reisbergen has it. 15:31 to go in a scoreless first half. Chicago and New York playing at Exhibition Stadium in Toronto. Right side to Zanino, and now Zanino comes into the penalty area. Back out of it. Here's Bogey. Bogey with a shot high, too far. Goal kick, Chicago with our score, 0-0. We've got 15 minutes remaining in the first half. Dieter Ferner, who has not been called to make the really difficult save tonight, distributes it out to Ingo Peter.
No, we just saw something which I think Cosmos fans feel they haven't seen nearly enough of for the past 2 years, and that was Bogey taking the shot. I mean, it wasn't a very good shot, but Bogey so frequently has found himself in good shooting positions, and he's looking around for somebody to pass to. It's become almost a sort of profession with him, the assist master.
Now the Cosmos coming forward. Nice bit of footwork by Zanino. Back to Canaya, then back to Zanino, and Canaya has it. Giorgio, Mathieu right there. Nice play.
Again, the quickness of Mathieu flicking out that leg and taking, well, he's still on the ball. He's chased that ball all over the place, and he's still got it. A deserved round of applause from the fans for that.
I think there may even be a few Cosmos fans applauding that bit of work by Franz Mathieu. Well, Giorgio said at the top of the show he didn't like the quickness that Mathieu brought to this sport. Now Ingo Peter is on Giorgio, and there is no foul call, though Giorgio was on the artificial surface.
Yeah, well, that was exactly, well, not quite exactly, but nearly exactly how the ball is, well, how they want to get the ball to Canaglia, running across, Canaglia running across the air, and the ball pushed into his right foot. Now there's Marhedic having to be fouled by Reisbergen, otherwise Marhedic again was going to do one of these little twisty things and get past him, but a foul out there near the touchline isn't going to worry anybody.
Ingo Peter, Derek Spalding. Should be taken by New York. It is. Bogey, one touch over the right. Durgan trying to get back to it. Taken away by Marhedic. Watch out now. He's one on three. Here's the shot.
Oh. Now, how dangerous can you get? Durgan making really quite a slight error back there, getting the ball trapped between his legs, and a defender near him to help him, and suddenly Marhedic is bursting out of the middle of it with the ball, gets around everybody, forces Birkenmaier again to come to the Cosmos rescue, because that ball was going in. No question about it.
Birkenmaier saved the day. It is a corner kick for Chicago. It'll be taken by Karl-Heinz Granitza. Again, the outswinger. The attempted header by Marhedic. Chicago controls Charlie Fikas, but center was too much.
Yeah, I don't think they'd have particularly wanted that ball to go to Marhedic on a header anyway.
That's across the far touchline. It'll be a throw-in for the Chicago Sting. No score, 12:47 to go in the first half. Naiskins and Marhedic battling for the... It is Marhedic.
Let's take a look at Marhedic bursting through these defenders here. And look, walking his way around two more there and getting off that shot, and that is clearly going exactly where he intended it, just inside the post. Birkenmeyer, a brilliant save, and again we've got one of these free kicks 35 yards out, and you think, well, that shouldn't be too dangerous, but just look, the Cosmos with four men in a wall there for a 35-yard free kick. I don't think I've ever seen this before.
Now, last time Granitza sent it over to the right, he's got Houston over to his right now. Let's see if he takes the shot. He does. It's deflected, and Birkenmeyer has to make us.
He still has to save it, exactly. The ball was thumped. It hit the wall. I wouldn't want to be the guy who it hit. You would see who it hit in the wall here, and it goes way up in the air, and it's going to fall down pretty well on the goal line there. But Birkenmeyer, of course, an easy save at that point. So the wall, in that sense, did its job there. It got in the way of that shot. Whether we've got a casualty as a result of it getting in the, him getting in the way of that shot, I certainly would have liked to be me, I must say.
Here are the Cosmos once again. 11:30 to go in the first half. Canalla, one touch, back to Bouillon, but Franz Mathieu is there to break it up again. Mathieu is going to run now. He and Granitza on the rumble. Mathieu to the right side. Granitza to Mathieu. Granitza back in the center. Here's the cross. It's headed out by Reisbergen.
This time, exactly, it's Reisbergen to the rescue. A very good cross from Mathieu, because it was the sort of cross that Birkenmeyer could not afford to go to. It was too far away from him, and he had to wait for something to happen. Luckily for him, the first man to get to the ball was one of his defenders, Reisbergen.
Marhedic easily spotted with that long, flowing blonde hair.
Marhedic trying to flick it across, trying to find the head of Steffenhagen, but hitting it too hard over Steffenhagen, over everybody, in fact. Goal kick for the Cosmos.
Marhedic, just 21, started his career at San Telmo in Argentina, came to Detroit and was their leading scorer a year ago, and then picked up by Chicago. Here come the Cosmos, 10:35 to go in the first half. Zanino looks to Niskins. Giorgio gets it. Mathieu is right there, and here's Houston, Dave Houston. Marhedic tries to get it right back to Houston, but it's taken away by Reisbergen, and Weggerly chases it into the corner. Marked closely by Hahn. Weggerly. There's Charlie Fikas, the takedown by Reisbergen, and New York controls. Bogisevic back to Bouillon, the twin Yugoslavs. Giorgio, and they double-teamed him with Paul Hahn that time, and Chicago has the ball.
And again, it's noticeable that there are some very quick people in the... Mathieu is very quick, Spalding is quick, Houston is quick, Hahn not so quick, but he's using his brain well back there, and they're getting to the ball very quickly. They're out hustling the New York forwards in defense.
Here's Hahn pushing up Houston, the right back. Back to Paul Hahn. Forward now.
Oh, dear. Uh-oh. The referee says that's a dive. Now that, of course, Steffenhagen is arguing with the referee over that. That, of course, is exactly what the Cosmos feared. It wasn't Granitza who, if you like, took a dive, or who was fouled, but a free kick in that position would have been exactly what Chicago were looking for and what New York fear most. Now, I look to me like the Cosmos were a little lucky to get a dive call on that, because there's no question that Durgan, I think, clattered into the back of Steffenhagen.
Well, Steffenhagen was letting Dante Maglio know what he thought of the call.
I should correct that. I don't think that was Durgan. I think that was Yerusha.
Here's Franz Mathieu of Chicago. Under 10 minutes to go. We're right at the 9-minute mark now in the first half. Remaining, that is. There's Hahn. Left side. Chicago with two near goals. And here comes the sting once again. The cross, looking for Granitza with the header.
Granitza, I think, this time fouling Durgan. Unquestionably pushing Durgan. Going for that ball.
That'll be a free kick for the Cosmos. With 8.5 to go in the first half.
We'll take a look at both running for the ball here as the ball comes over. Granitza signaling for it. He's going to get it. Now, he's got his eyes on the ball, but you can see he's leaning, and there's an elbow in there. And Durgan, in fact, we might almost say that that was turned round, and that instead of Durgan fouling Granitza and Granitza taking a dive, it was the other way around.
Here's another foul call just outside the offside line, and the Cosmos will have the free kick. Take a look at the foul, Paul.
No, we see Yerushi coming in, and that's Ingo Peter coming across there. And as you can see, not really getting to the ball, and Yerushi having to trip over an outstretched leg.
Bouillon for New York. Back to Bogisevic. They look for Niskins. Now Mathieu. There he is again. Danger, though, on the left. Zanino has it. Now taken away nearly and done so by Derek Spalding. Here comes Steffenhagen, but he's not quick enough to get to the ball. And Eskandarian gets it back to Birkenmeyer.
Eskandarian racing back because he'd been involved in that attack, racing back to cover and doing an effective, if not very aesthetically pleasing job.
7:30 remaining first half. No score. Chicago and New York. Soccer Bowl 81 from Toronto. Vern Lundquist along with Paul Gardner. Here's Ivan Bouillon, number 22. Back to Bogisevic, wearing number 8. And watch out. Here's Yerushi, who doesn't shoot all that often. On the ground, and it's deflected. Canalia, Giorgio, tries to swing it around, and Mathieu is there. But Bogisevic has it back for the Cosmos. Weggerly.
Weggerly protecting the ball beautifully there. A reckless tackle by Mathieu. That's one of the problems. Mathieu complaining. And free kick right outside the penalty area, which, again, if it were at the other end, I think this would be imminent danger. The Cosmos do not have the Granica-type effectiveness on free kicks, but for any team, this is a very dangerous situation.
Bogisevic and Canalia surround the ball, and Maglio is pushing the wall back the reportedly necessary 10 yards.
Well, they'll be lucky if they get 8. They'll settle for 8, I think.
They are supposed to be 10 yards back from the ball. One touch. Giorgio fisted out by Dieter Ferner.
Vicious right foot drive by Giorgio Canalia and fisted out. Could no hope for holding on to that for Dieter Ferner. He did what he could, fisted it out, and luckily it went to his own players.
Eskandarian. That is as close as the Cosmos have come to putting it in the net here in the first half.
Well, you can see the wall doing its job there because the wall narrows down the angle at which the player can shoot. Giorgio Canalia got off the shot he wanted, but he had to hit it where there was space, and that meant it had to go straight at the goalkeeper.
Marhedic battling Marhedic with Reisbergen. They'll call the foul on Reisbergen.
Grabbed by Reisbergen. Not a very serious foul, that. Well, we're seeing it from the goalkeeper, straight at the goalkeeper, a little bit to his right maybe. And you can see punched out and punched solidly out, not just sort of dribbled out where somebody can pick up a rebound.
5:35 remaining in the first half. We have no score. Here's Paul Hahn. Over to Dave Hewson, right side. The volley attempted by the Sting, and Weggerly trying to get to it.
The volley attempted by Spalding, it turned into a rather bad pass instead of a thundering shot.
In go Peter for Chicago, and he overshoots Pato Marhedic. It'll come the other direction. The Cosmos have it. We have 5:04 remaining. We have no score.
Here we go.
Just under 5 minutes remaining in the first half. Chicago and New York from Toronto, Canada. I think unexpectedly scoreless at this point. Little surprise.
Well, of course, we've had a possibility, I suppose, of 3 goals here, in fact.
Right.
Two brilliant saves by Birkenmeyer to our right, and one that we've just seen by Dieter Ferner on that free kick by Giorgio Canalia to our left. So.
Eskandarian, Ferner up in the air.
Well, Ferner looking like he might have slightly misjudged the flight of that ball, having to lean backwards to grab it, but ultimately doing it, you know, putting a few hearts in a few mouths, but ultimately doing a good solid job on it. Maybe he's just trying to make it exciting for us.
Dave Hewson.
See, Dave Hewson, a fullback, but he ought to know a lot about attack. Oh, look out.
Here's Marhedic. Oh, they try to get through to Granica.
Well, I think this time, Chicago have got what they wanted this time.
That is the really first free kick they will have been awarded.
This, of course, this is where all the trouble's going to start, because this is precisely the situation that they've been trying to avoid. That was Stefan Hagen who was brought down. The Cosmos, to their credit, are not arguing that call.
And watch out for the left foot of Karl-Heinz Granica.
Placing the ball where he wanted.
19 goals on the year. 10 came from situations like this.
The Cosmos have got everybody back in their own penalty area. I can't imagine how many players they're going to have in that wall. They must have 6 players in that wall. Birkenmeyer must be wondering what to do, because if that ball comes over the wall and drops down in that angle, Birkenmeyer is not going to get to it.
You know, I can't help but think that Karl-Heinz is kind of smiling. Here's the kick.
And again, you could see that ball rising, and you're just thinking, well, it's going to go over and dip. But again, he clipped a little bit of the wall. And as we got on the 35-yard kick, earlier on, this will be a corner kick, and Granica himself will go over to deal with that.
Here's the corner kick. We'll have the commissioner, Phil Woosnam, with us at halftime, as well as the immortal Pele. That's coming up at the half. which is just a couple of minutes away. Here's Charlie Ficus of Chicago to Houston. Taken away in Canalia, but it's a one-on-three situation right now. Giorgio doesn't have any help. He's looking for it. And here comes Zanino. Giorgio still has it.
And his pass to Zanino, obviously not a good one. More of this derisive booing from the Chicago fans there, but that was not an easy situation for a center forward. Breaking alone with the ball from deep in his own half, in fact, he's got about 60 yards to run with the ball.
Now Arno Steffenhagen. Pushed through, left side, and deflected. That'll result in a goal kick for the Cosmos of New York. Cosmos have been in the final match four times in the history of the league, and they've yet to be defeated. They were knocked out in the semifinal by Vancouver in 79, but New York won it in 77, 78, and 80.
Referee's going to make them retake that goal kick on a technicality. The ball is supposed to go outside of the penalty area before it can be played by another player, and Reisbergen touched it before it had gone outside the penalty area.
Chicago nothing, New York nothing, just before halftime. Jeff Durgan, one of his few ventures across the midfield stripe from Tacoma, Washington. Back to Canalia. Now Bogisevich. And headed out. Cosmos control again. Here's Giorgio with Mathieu behind him. Nice shot by Giorgio.
Incredible shot by Giorgio. I didn't think he had a hope of getting to that ball because he didn't control it very well on the first one. But that sudden turn, sudden right foot volley.
Saw the graphic that Giorgio was the MVP of the league this year. That is the one honor in this league he had never won. And it meant quite a bit to him when he was so named by his peers. Ferner trying to find Rudy Glenn out near midfield, and there'll be a foul called on Ivan Bouillon, I believe.
I think it's called on Rudy Glenn.
Oh, it is.
Yeah, they were both going for the ball, and Glenn was sort of elbowing his way in front of Bouillon to get to the ball.
Long kick by Bogisevich, taken relatively easily by Ferner, and he will punt it out near midfield where the only one in black down there is Karl-Heinz Granica, and hello.
Durgan, right now you see that. Again, the Cosmos not arguing that call, walking away. Durgan going way high and evidently putting an elbow or a fist or something into the back of his Granica going up, and you can see Durgan is way over the top coming down, and he must be damaging him when he's coming down on top of him.
He is also, Paul, wearing a bit of a cast on his right wrist, Durgan,
yeah.
We're talking about.
Yeah.
I wonder if that may have had an impact.
Well, if it had, then it's a clear example of why those things shouldn't be worn. Although, again, you know, I'm not too sure that I agree with that call, because it seemed to me that Granica did not jump for that ball.
Ingo Peter, they'll struggle for it in the goal mouth there, and it'll go across the end line. Now let's see if it's a corner or a goal kick. Looks like it'll be a corner kick to be taken by Chicago. There's a good look at Ingo Peter. Here's the in-swinger this time, and Dante Muglio says it's time, halftime. And it's halftime with our score, Chicago nothing, and the Cosmos of New York nothing. Halftime in Toronto, Canada for Soccer Bowl 81. The Chicago Sting nothing, the New York Cosmos nothing, with 45 minutes yet to play. We are at halftime. I'm Vern Lundquist once again, and with us here at the half is the commissioner of the North American Soccer League. He has been for an awful long time, Phil Woosnam. Phil, thank you for coming by. I know this has been a very difficult year for the league, has it not?
It's been difficult. We've had a number of unusual problems to deal with over the last 18 months, actually, in labor negotiations, FIFA problems, and of course, we've reduced our membership in recent weeks from 21 franchises to 16.
You have been, since I've known you, and that goes on a decade now, among the most optimistic of men. Can you possibly be as optimistic about the future of this league, given the kind of problems you've had this year?
Oh, certainly. Those are the sort of problems that all sports leagues face up to from time to time. In fact, as far as the reduction of the number of teams is concerned, we worked hard and long last year to try and find a plan that could reduce it to 16. Many of the franchise owners believe that we're better off, we're stronger, with just 16 franchises. A better identification as far as the fans are concerned with the players throughout the league.
Do you see still soccer becoming the sport of the 80s, which was a widely trumpeted phrase back in the late 70s?
Certainly. During the 70s, certainly in the second part of the 70s, after Pelé arrived, there was a tremendous bulge at the youth level, boys and girls playing the sport, and now it's number two in the country, second only to baseball. It takes 10 years for a 12-year-old to become a 22-year-old, by which time we've either got great professional players or we've got ticket buyers as far as our attendance is concerned. So I think it's all going to happen in the second part of the 80s. By that time, the national team, and that's very important to the development of the sport, the World Cup team will be a good team in both Canada and the United States. And once we make an impact in world soccer, then we'll see the attendances grow. Then we'll see the media respond and the sponsorships respond and so on.
Well, you've got a heck of a crowd here in Toronto for this match.
Well, it's great to see them here, particularly after a disappointing season for them. And I know the club has got to be very satisfied to attract such a large crowd tonight for this game.
Thank you, Phil, very much. Phil Wisdom, the commissioner of the North American Soccer League. We are at halftime, and coming up, a conversation with one of the truly greats in this sport, Pelé. That'll be right after this.
Just imagine flying to Europe free. Just for flying TWA
at 81. Paul Gardner and I have been joined by the most recognizable face, I guess, in the history of the sport, Pelé. I'm used to introducing you as a great player, but I'm introducing you as a movie star now. You had a tremendous time, I guess, making Victory with Sylvester Stallone and Michael Caine.
Oh, yes. Fortunately, it was my first big experience, you know? And the film came very well. It was very successful in New York and Night State. That was a surprise because kind of film of soccer we expect in Europe or South America to be more successful. But we have to say thank you for John Huston because he has idea and we in the United States was okay.
Now then, to the film star, a question about soccer, about today's game. Do you feel that the Cosmos are a little too cautious in this game, that they seem to be a bit afraid of Chicago here?
Yeah, no doubt. I have to tell the truth, the honest. I think Chicago, you know, Chicago beat Cosmo twice this year, there and in New York. And the Cosmo played very carefully. They didn't come often normally as a normal. The game became a little slow. I think technically it was fantastic.
Yeah. Technically, yes, but
was
in
very
terms
good.
Of what the Cosmos could do if they push forward rapidly, they're not doing
exactly,
that.
Exactly, they're not doing that. And we have, you know, two or three very good saves from Beckham, the goalkeeper of the Cosmos. This give the possibility to Chicago come for. I think Cosmos now should be more aggressive, you know.
So we hope for a more aggressive second half.
Exactly, yeah. No doubt. We have to use more the left wing. We don't use because he's very skilled.
I notice you still say we here, Pelé.
I say we because I belong to the Cosmos. I can lie. But I think this second half of the game will be much better.
We can expect goals in the second
exactly.
half.
Exactly. Yeah. Oh, everybody's expect to go. The public is here, they share, they want to go. The public who see the game on TV, they want to go to, and we expect to go. Doesn't matter now, honestly. Doesn't matter who win. Important, you see goals. If it was a 4-3 or 5-2 to Chicago, but it's okay. That's important, is goals.
I wonder how many goals would have been scored if Pelé had been playing today.
Nobody knows, but one thing is true. I will try hard.
Okay, Pelé, it is always a pleasure to have you with us. Thanks so much for coming back again.
Thank you. I hope the people have a luck now in the second half and see a lot of goals.
All right, Pelé, we are at halftime once again in Toronto, Canada. Halftime with our score, Chicago nothing and the Cosmos nothing, but Pelé says we will have goals and we'll be back. Halftime stats, shots on goal, Chicago 6, 3 taken by Granitza, New York has 7, 4 taken by Giorgio Canaglia. 3 saves for Dieter Ferner, 4 for Hubert Birkenmeier, 9 fouls, 10 for New York, 5 corner kicks to 1. That is the only area on the stat sheet that shows a wide edge to one team. There's Karl-Heinz Granitza.
Karl-Heinz Granitza looking for more shots on goal, obviously, and more free kicks. Although the shots on goal pattern there, 7 for New York, 6 for Chicago, doesn't really reflect the quality of those shots. The greater danger came from Chicago, without a doubt.
Giorgio Canaglia. And Dante Maglio places the ball down as the Cosmos go left to right as we begin the second half of Soccer Bowl 81. Bogišević sends it back to Johan Neeskens, and he'll go left side to Eskandarian. Andronic Eskandarian, and it comes through, stolen by Chicago. Here's the takeaway from Paul Hahn. Hahn with the rebound. Lays it off and runs on through. He's down the right side. But Granitza holds it up, and it'll be taken back by the Cosmos' Jeff Durgan. Neeskens back to Eskandarian, and he'll shove it backwards to Hubert Birkenmeyer.
And we've got the same teams on the field as started this game. There have been no substitutions at all yet, which is a sign, I think, of the, if you like, the solid soccer background of both coaches who are not big substitutors, Weisweiler in particular.
Here's Canaglia with Franz Mathieu, headed out of there by Rudy Glenn. And on the right side, the Sting comes forward. Nice pass forward. Watch out. This is Houston. Houston at the edge of the penalty box. Yarushi comes over. Here's Granica. Watch him with the left foot. He can't get it away. And Naiskin slides and hits the ball across the near touchline.
He couldn't get it away because Durgan was in very quickly and stretched his body at full length to push that ball away. Otherwise, that was precisely what Granica wanted to do. He was setting up his left foot.
Pato Marhedic. Marhedic trying to get around Reisbergen, and they're doing a waltz down there in the corner.
Well, the referee is called sort of pushing, pulling, holding, or whatever you want to call it, on Marhedic, because he flicked the ball over Reisbergen's head. Reisbergen running for it. You could say Reisbergen was obstructing him, but the referee decided to say that Reisbergen was trying to play the ball and that Marhedic was trying to pull him out of the way. You can't do that.
Birkenmeyer, long kick, way downfield. It'll be taken by Chicago, then reobtained by the Cosmos. Jim Reisbergen. Marhedic goes after it. Reisbergen, nice save.
Yeah, well, I think if it comes to a sort of test of strength between Reisbergen's legs and Marhedic's, which that was basically, then you're going to go with Reisbergen.
This is Seninho. He was a medic in the Angolan Civil War years ago. Portuguese citizen. And back to Bogišević. Left-footed shot through to Wegerle. Watch out! Wegerle, Mathieu almost took him down to the penalty area, and the referee does not call the
foul. I think Mathieu was a little lucky to get away with that there, because he did touch Wegerle, and it's very surprising to me. And in a way, I've got to say I'm glad to see it, although it may have cost the Cosmos a penalty kick. Surprising to me that Wegerle didn't simply fall over, because that's the way the game's been going in the last 10 or 15 years. Rather than attempt to play the ball, just for the slightest provocation, fall over in the penalty area and hope to get the penalty kick.
Back heel pass by Bogišević to Reisbergen. Now right side to Steve Wegerle, and he cannot keep it in play. It'll be a throw-in.
Let's take a look at this, Whitten. That Mathieu running across him there, and you can see just kicked. Well, maybe the referee was right on that. Maybe, in fact, Wegerle slipped rather than Mathieu playing him there.
Here's the play into Canaglia. Giorgio hits the near side.
Dieter Ferner wondering where on earth that went, looking off to the far side of the goal. And in fact, it had bounced on the outside of the post and gone over the goal line for a goal kick. But there's some dirty looks being directed towards the linesman.
41:30 to go in the regulation time. No score, Chicago and New York. Ingo Peter in the center circle. Now comes left. He'll try and split the difference between Bogey and Bouillon. He does. And then the ball is kicked out and cleared. And Wegerle being chased by Houston. Houston wins this battle. Dave Houston. Karl-Heinz Granica back to Houston on the run. He'll have the cross. There it is. Far post. Hit it. It hit the post.
Well, Ingo Peter. Can't believe quite what he did there, and that was some marvelous work by Dave Houston, who's on the ground. Look at his stride here. Look at his stride. Beautiful loping cross. He got it over Birkenmeyer. That is absolute perfect placing. Birkenmeyer can't do it. Ingo Peter in there, the header, and off the crossbar and off the post. He hit the crossbar and the post.
There was the corner, and again Chicago thwarted. That is the third time that they've been close to putting something on the board. The first two times, fine, Birkenmeyer saves. This time, it was the post and the crossbar, and we'll look again.
This is Houston loose on the right, and this beautiful sort of lofted center that Birkenmeyer on the near post can't quite get to. And there's the header, post.
And the corner. Chest trap by the Cosmos Bogišević, and a foul called. It'll be called against the Chicago Sting. Rudy Glenn. And we'll look at it again.
Now this time we're going to look at it. Birkenmeyer stretching, clawing, grabbing, cannot get to it. And there's the header. Not particularly, not enough power on it maybe, but one that, as you can see, if it had been well directed, must have gone into the goal because Birkenmeyer was out of the play.
So we remain scoreless. No score in the match. We have 40 minutes remaining in regulation play. Johan Naiskens from the Netherlands throwing it into Seninho. Seninho to Bogišević, number 8. Marked by Rudy Glenn, also wearing number 8. Here's Ivan Bouillon. The center by Bouillon, looking for Canaglia. one-handed out of there by Ferner, and then deflected as the shot is taken with the left foot on the right side by Cedinho.
Dangerous living in the Chicago defense there, because people not really getting hold of the ball, starting with the goalkeeper who didn't really clear it.
I go back to that header by Ingo Peter that hit the crossbar. What a great play by Dave Hewson.
Absolutely. He ran a long way for that ball. He caught up with it because he does have tremendous speed. We saw him outpace Weggerly just now, and he got over what couldn't have been a better center in a way, because he had to get it past Birkenmaier from almost no angle, and Birkenmaier was on the near post, and he got it, as you saw, just over Birkenmaier.
Free kick now to be taken by the Cosmos. Bogišević keeps it low, and Granica right foots it back toward Bogišević.
Well, that's an example of Granica's right foot. You can see why he shoots with his left.
Here's Eskandarian. Number two, headed down by Jeff Durgan. Goes back to Bob Yarushi. Nice pass for Cedinho, who's on the fly. Chest trap by Cedinho, but Paul Hahn comes over and takes it away, and we are still scoreless. Cedinho with the throw-in for the Cosmos in white. And the scissors kick half-heartedly attempted by Naiskens, and it'll be a throw-in for Chicago. Steffen Hagen. Arno's been kind of quiet in
this
game.
Yes, we've not seen much of Arno. And we've seen, well, in fact, of course, Mahedic and Steffen Hagen are the sort of players that you see in flashes, and all you need really is a couple of flashes from them to win the game for you. Mahedic almost did it in the first half. Steffen Hagen has yet to prove that he can do it.
Here's Ingo Peter again, forward to Granica. Give and go, Granica with the deflection, and Reisbergen takes it for the Cosmos.
And again, an example of perhaps what Pelé was talking about in the first half, the Cosmos picking up that ball there, and the first thing the Bogey did with it was to play it backwards.
No score in the match. Chicago and New York, Soccer Bowl 81. Here's Steve Weggerly. This could be dangerous. Nope, it's not. Taken away by Paul Hahn. Hahn now loses it to Naiskens, but a foul is called on Cedinho. It'll come Chicago's direction.
Cedinho almost is his own worst enemy on those. He's so quick to run back and cover that it seems though he can't put on the brakes quick enough, and he crashes into the back of the player with the ball.
Arno Steffen Hagen far side. He's only 5'9", looks even a little bit shorter than that.
Yeah, but do you remember how he got up on that first header from the corner kick there? He might have been 7 foot tall on that one.
That'll be a throw in Chicago on the far side.
Giorgio Canaglia very unhappy about the way things are going at the moment. He's run back well inside his own half and is gesturing and shouting at his teammates. Here he is trying to pick up the ball, but he won't get that. Mathieu beats him to it.
Now let's see what France does with it. Comes left side and overshoots Charlie Ficus, and it'll be taken by Naiskens. To Cedinho, back to Johan. Ficus chases him. It's at the center circle with Bogišević. Now left side to Bouillon. Bouillon over to Bob Yarushi, the Toronto's native. And he tries to shove it through, but Hahn deflects it with those red laces on his shoes. And here's Paul Hahn to Granica. Well, not very carefully trapped by or taken care of by Carl Hines.
No, it's Derek Spalding there, with slide tackling the ball. It went straight up in the air, and while he's looking around for it, it bounces down on his back and goes for a throw into the Cosmos.
Ivan Bouillon.
Now, Granica had a great chance just now to get something going. He let the ball run under his foot, and Durgan, who, as he remarked at the head of the program, wasn't going to play him too tight, was able to get in and kick the ball away.
Here comes Bouillon. Durgan has gone through now. He's inside the penalty box. They try and find Jeff Durgan, but it's kicked out to the left side and taken by Derek Spalding. There's a good look at the 20-year-old Jeff Durgan. Just had a birthday recently. His second year as a starter with the Cosmos.
Jeff Durgan must be the youngest player on this field today, and I guess Pater Mahedic of the Sting is the next youngest. There's only about a year between them.
Ingo Peter, Charlie Ficus, number 9. Naiskens tries to make the steal, but his call for the foul instead. It'll go back toward the Chicago net. And Naiskens is a picture of effort, isn't he? He's always running after the ball.
He's absolutely indefatigable, and of course he's so...
That was a shot by Spalding.
He's so sort of uncaring of his own well-being. Well, he is reckless at times, but most of the time it seems to be sheer exuberance, sheer enthusiasm. He just flings himself at the ball from any angle, and he always seems to be able to do something with it. It's not just sort of wild kicking in all directions.
No score. We're midway through the second half.
Off the white-bellied jet that lands me to a hotel that understands me. I've got business and I'm on the road again.
Dutch team in 74 in West Germany and 78 in Argentina.
Yes, and of course we got another one on the field, Wim Rijsbergen. The blonde defender of the Cosmos, the man who's marking the other blonde, Mahedic, this afternoon, was also on that 74 team, not on the 78 finalists. He got injured.
Chicago throw in near side. They're looking for Granica. Bob Yarushi is behind him, so's Jeff Durgan, but look at this, and he overshoots Ficus.
Well, the Cosmos have got to be asking themselves how on earth Ficus got all that space right in the middle of the heart of the Cosmos defense for that cross, which luckily for them wasn't too good a one from Granica. And I think what you've got to say is that they're so frightened of Granica that they all ran out to the right of the defense, and Ficus was able to go in there absolutely unattended.
No score in the match. Here's Rudy Glenn. Right side, look for the center. It's deflected, and the Cosmos, Bogisevich, tries to keep it in and kicks it over the far touchline. That'll be a throw in Chicago.
Well, Bogey, you really have to laugh at Bogey. Because running back, he played that ball, and I think most players would have known that was going for a corner and would have flung and dived at it. Bogey just lolloped after it. A little bit of barging from both sides there, from Granica and Durgan, as they went for that ball there. The referee didn't call anything. Bogey just ran after it. And I was convinced he was going to play it beautifully back, and he whacked it into the touch.
Long kick by Birkenmeyer. Willie Roy, the head coach of Chicago. Hennis Weisweiler, the head coach of the Cosmos. Here's Charlie Ficus. Ficus, that's too much and too strong. And it'll be a throw-in Cosmos with 33 minutes remaining in the second half. Eskandarian. Long kick through, but Ingo Peter takes it away for Chicago. Now back to Bouillon, and Franz Mathieu.
Again, Franz Mathieu getting in quickly, and with that, as I say, characteristic and rather wild sort of kicking of his, cleared it, but really not very well because it went straight into touch.
Rijsbergen into Marhedic, Pato Marhedic. He and Rijsbergen having a shove at each other's shirts.
Well, that was Mahedic's claiming that Rijsbergen elbowed him, but as I saw it, Mahedic lost control of that ball, and Rijsbergen was able to get in front of him, at which point, of course, there's Wegerle and Houston having a bit of a battle over there.
And the favor goes toward Steve Wegerle. It'll be a free kick for the Cosmos. That's the 13th foul called against Chicago in the match.
Here's Bogey with that characteristic swinging body motion of his taking a free kick. Well, there's
Zanino
missed it. Not controlling the ball, doing what Granica did earlier on.
Granica back to Rudy Glenn. And here comes the sting. Spalding to Granica. Through back to, taken away by Bob Yarushi. Now nice. Ficus almost gets it back.
Ficus, in fact, forced Yarushi into an error on that because Yarushi was trying to find Zanino, and his pass was short. This is why Chicago Stinger back in control of the ball here.
Marhedic. Pato Marhedic from Argentina. That'll be taken by Eskandarian.
Being chased every step of the way by Wim Rijsbergen from Holland.
Naeskens to Rijsbergen. Back to Rijsbergen again. This is Bogisevich. Oh, my goodness, you could hear Wim.
Oh, Wim Rijsbergen is going to go off. Wim Rijsbergen must go off for that, surely.
Johan Naeskens is chasing Granica, and Maglio is going to have his hands full to separate these two sides.
Well, that was an ugly looking foul. And you can hear there's an awful lot of shouting going on out there,
Canalia trying to calm things down. Rijsbergen, they're going to bring the trainer on from the far side as Granica is still down, just outside the offside mark.
That was, I think that's Rudy.
Rudy Glenn
is down, who committed the foul. And it was a bad foul from behind on Rijsbergen. Now, if the referee or the linesman saw what Rijsbergen did in way of retaliation, then he must go off.
Maglio is trying to keep the peace now before he assesses the penalty. and indicates whether it'll be, I think it's just a matter of yellow or red card. Do you think it's worthy of red card?
Well, he's got a lot of options here. He can say, look, the foul was worth the red card, and so was Rijsbergen's retaliation. And the red card, of course, means that the player is chucked out of the game, in which case nobody can replace them. Both teams would be playing with 10 men. Or he can say the foul was worth a yellow card, a warning, and the retaliation was worth the red. At the moment, I see no cards, red, green, yellow, orange, pink, or blue. Oh, let's have a look at it. This is the pass from Bogey, and he made it with his right foot, funnily enough, a little push with the right foot. Now, you see, there's the foul from the back, and you can see Rijsbergen going down in agony, gets up, and you can see what he does there. And here come, we're gonna see some cards here now, I think.
Rudy Glenn and Ingo Peter talking it over.
I see yellow. And I think the referee, and I think this may be the most sensible thing to do if he's simply going to give them both a yellow.
See, Rudy Glenn is gesturing at Rijsbergen. Rijsbergen is up and limping as he heads away from the melee now.
The card, in fact, is back in the referee's pocket, and it's not clear to me whether two yellows or one yellow have been given. Rijsbergen being escorted by Joel Rosenstein, the Cosmos trainer. He wants to take a further look at him. He's got some damage to that leg. So the Cosmos, I would think, for the moment, nope, they're not. Rijsbergen is going off, and Julio Cesar Romero, the Paraguayan player. Now, what a player to have on the bench. 2 years ago, we're going to take a look at the foul again. Rijsbergen, and you can see a really clumsy and brutal foul, and Rijsbergen up again, and his leg up and his knee up into Rudy Grin.
And incredibly, no cards. No. So we still have no score. Now Iskandarian will take the free kick. There were no cards issued by Dante Moglio. There's Mathieu kicking it out. No. Paul, how do you feel about that?
I think there was a card. I saw the card out in his hand. I saw him writing on it, but it looked to me as though he was giving a yellow to Rudy Glenn and ignoring the retaliation from Rijsbergen.
Well, we've got the official word now. He didn't hold it up and
no, he didn't brandish it,
but there were yellow cards issued to Neeskens and to Glenn.
Well, Glenn obviously for the foul. Neeskens must have been for protesting or something, because he wasn't involved in the original incident.
Well, we've settled down now, and we're back to play on the far side. Jeff Durgan holding the ball. It'll be a throw-in for the...
Well, it's the throw-in's got to be repeated, because Ingo Peter, who was taking it, stole about 30 yards on the throw. Well, 30 yards, I'm exaggerating a little. 2 yards, shall we say?
And now we're going to have a goal kick for the Cosmos. No score in the match. 30 minutes remaining.
And I started to remark, when Rijsbergen went off, the substitute who came on for the Cosmos was Julio Cesar Romero, who... I mean, what a player to have on the bench, because 2 years ago, this player, Romero, was the South American Player of the Year, the best player in South America, a continent that includes players like Zico and Falcao, and did, of course, even in those days, include Maradona, who's won it twice since then. So as a player on the bench, Romero can't be bad.
Word is he's had a disappointing season, but he's really been injured quite a bit.
He's had some sort of aggravations of injuries as well. He has had a disappointing season, it's true, but he came on quite well in the playoff games.
Bogišević with a free kick. They're looking for Yarushi, and Yarushi has it go over the end line, so it'll be a goal kick, and we still have no score.
The interesting thing is what that substitution is going to do to the shape of this game, because Rijsbergen has been taking care of Marhedic. Who will take care of Marhedic now? Not, I think, Romero.
There's Dieter Ferner, Sting goalkeeper. Here's Spalding, held up from behind, and that'll be a free kick that'll be awarded to the Sting. Sininho grabbed the jersey.
It looks like Marhedic's afternoon is going to be full of Dutchmen, because he's got rid of one of them, Marhedic, and now I think it's going to be Neeskens, the other Dutchman on the field, who's going to take care of him.
So Neeskens will move back then.
Well, Neeskens will be forced, I would imagine, into a more defensive role. Romero will take over the attacking, here he is, in fact, with the ball.
Romero to Bogišević, stolen by Paul Hahn. And Chicago turns it around and will try the counterattack. Lovely pass. Paul Hahn down the right side. Now watch for the center. Here it comes. And it's fisted out by Birkenmeyer. Birkenmeyer's down. Granica goes over to control it. And Bullion is taken down in the penalty area. Foul against Chicago. Free kick, New York.
Well, a lot of action there involved, because once again, a dangerous-looking cross coming from the right, this time from Paul Hahn. And what a good-looking player this man is. playing at sweeper. This is the sweeper, right out, almost in the right-hand corner. And that was slightly deflected. And again, Birkenmeyer having to push it out and really not doing a good job at all on that. Mahedic got to it, pushed it back into play, but the result of it was a foul by Ingo Peter.
There's a rather poor kick over on the far side, and the Cosmos will have a throw-in over there. It'll be taken by Bogisevic. Vladislav Bogisevic. Bogey really has come on in the last couple of years. Here's Wegerle trying to find room. Canaya, watch out. And the kick is taken and deflected. Oh, my goodness. Romero. Giorgio had to lay off the ball when Romero came through.
Exactly. There was so much confusion there. Giorgio could not control that ball properly, and it just wasn't there when he wanted it. So it was better to leave it in the sense to Romero who was running through at full speed, and he took a shot, and he took it well, because there was probably only a foot or two in that going inside the post or out.
That results in a corner kick for the Cosmos. This will be only their second corner of the night. It'll be taken by Steve Wegerle.
Well, we remember what happened to the first one. This is a better one. Not much better.
There's the kick. And Eskandarian controls for the Cosmos. Marhedic tries to get it back. Can't. Ball is up for grabs. And Rudy Glenn is up and over the top of Bouillon. But the Cosmos Eskandarian has control. Now the kick to the left of Steve Wegerle. No good.
Now this, the ball coming through to Giorgio, and you can see he's going to have problems controlling this. He's got in between Spalding and Mathieu, but there the ball gets away. It's on his left foot, where he doesn't really want it. He plays it, he overruns it, he turns around. Romero comes in, slams it, and then really only a foot wide of that post.
Tell you, Giorgio.
So action at both ends here, but still, incredibly, no goals.
Here's Derek Spalding, left wing. Tries to get it across to the far post, does too far. And headed across the far touch line, it'll be a Chicago throw-in to be taken by Dave Hewson. Number 16. No score in the match. We've got 25, 26 minutes remaining. There's a rather weak kick taken across the end line by Ingo Peter. It'll be a goal kick for the New York Cosmos. Back to play now, Eskandarian has it. We come to you from Exhibition Stadium in Toronto. The Cosmos and the Chicago Sting in Soccer Bowl 81, a scoreless match thus far.
Well, with the Cosmos not leading, and in fact, their goal having been in considerable danger twice recently, it's surprising to me to see Hubert Birkenmeyer punting the ball long downfield like that. I would have thought possession would have been the important thing for the Cosmos.
Bouillon, Canaya, scissors kick. Oh, my goodness! Marvelously timed by Canaya, and Furner was able to save it.
Beautifully saved by Dieter Furner, because those are not easy kicks to save, because you're never sure where the ball's going. The player has his back to you, you can't see the ball, and suddenly there are flying legs and arms everywhere, and out of the middle of all that comes a rocket at 60 miles an hour. Dieter Furner did marvelously well to save it. Now take a look at it, because the ball, once again, Mathieu makes a mistake on this, the sort of mistake that he really doesn't want to make. He goes for the ball, you can see he sticks out a leg, and he doesn't really get hold of it, and Giorgio has time to wait. And in fact, I'm looking at it, one's a little surprised that dangerous play wasn't called on Giorgio there, because he almost took, I think it was Hahn's nose off with that kick. Stefan Hagen.
Canaya is looking for his 200th goal in the North American Soccer League. That includes playoffs and regular season play. He's got 199. 44 of them have come in the playoffs, including six this year. Here come the Cosmos again. Durgan, but it's too long, and Derek Spalding kicks it back to Furner. The official attendance, 36,971 here at Exhibition Stadium. Good crowd.
Well, that bicycle kick, beautifully executed by Giorgio, has certainly brought the Cosmos fans here to life. We can hear that rhythmic singing chant of theirs.
No score in the match, a battle for it at midfield. It'll come across the near sideline. And Derek Spalding will be responsible for throwing it in, which he does back to Paul Hahn. Only one substitution in the match so far. Romero came on for Reisbergen about 5 minutes ago. There's Paul Hahn tripped up. The foul will be called on Sonino. Free kick, Chicago.
This is Sonino protesting very loudly and very obviously to the referee that wasn't a trip, but I really can't see how he can do that. It looked like a pretty clear trip to me. Now look at this. He's all over him, and he finally gets it. You can see it. I mean, that couldn't be a clearer trip. I wonder why Sonino. Maybe it's not a trip in Portugal.
No score in the match. Free kick coming up for Chicago.
And Sonino is one of those people who is the nicest man and the mildest of men off the field.
Here's the battle for it. Niskins wins it, and Yarushi kicks it back. But Chicago controls Hahn. Now Sonino and Hahn battle for it. Bogusevic nicely touched, but Rudy Glenn is there. Now Hahn. And, oh, my goodness, Houston is almost loose. He's trying to get by Bouillon.
He's a tricky little player for a fullback. Of course, Houston used to be a winger, I'm remembering now. His position was changed. He was a forward. He was an attacker, a winger. So he must know all about how to deal with fullbacks.
Here's Marhedic, the blonde, to another blonde. Charlie Ficus. Romero tries to take it away. There's another blonde, Rudy Glenn.
Now, it's a pity, pity indeed that Peter played that ball, because it could have gone all the way through to Houston, who's open on the right. Well, it's finally got to him, but this time Bullion's a little closer to him.
Ficus calls for the ball and gets it back from Houston. Now watch for the cross. Here it comes. No help there.
Whoops.
And deflected. Oh, my goodness.
Eskandarian wondering exactly where that ball came from so suddenly. And he raised it. He got it off his knee, I think. That could so easily have gone into his own goal. All it's resulted is yet another corner kick for Chicago.
Kyle Heinz Granitza will take the corner. Birkenmeier set. Swings it out again. The header, one hopper, Birkenmeier with the save.
Once again, Ingo Peter, the guy who hit the post and the bar with a header earlier on, heading it down exactly as the books say you should, but in fact heading it down too much, because that ball bounced up in front of Birkenmeier, and that's not what you want. You want it to bounce where about, oh dear, whatever his fight is doing.
Steve Wegerle for the Cosmos, deflected. Here comes Houston. He has been a mighty mite tonight, all over the place.
And he's going, continue to go forward. He's picked up the ball again here.
This is about an 80-yard run, and Houston finally tries to get it back. It's kicked across the far side.
You'll take a look at that header again. This is from the angle of the corner. As the corner comes over, a high one, Ingo Peter is able to go up pretty well unmarked, and you see he heads it down and it bounces up. Makes it rather easy for Birkenmeier. The idea is to head it down towards his feet.
This week, couples
on Sunday at 9.
Back to play with 21-18 remaining in the game. No score. That's regulation time. If it should end up tied at the end of regulation, we have sudden death overtime. And if at the end of 15 minutes of sudden death there is no score, we go to the North American Soccer League shootout.
I think, though, somehow or other you can sense, can you not, Vern, that this game is going to produce a goal quite soon now, because both teams seem to be realizing that they want to finish this game in 90 minutes, and there's an urgency, if you like, an extra tension in the play, which is causing mistakes, which is causing errors, and that's the sort of stuff that goals are made of.
Here's Ivan Bouillon out to Eskandarian for the Cosmos. Back to Bob Yarushi. Well, we both, I think, expected a high-scoring game, and here we are scoreless with 20 minutes to go.
Well, looked at in retrospect, of course, it's almost inconceivable that the game could have got this far without at least one goal. Romero, but not a very strong shot, that it could have got this far without a goal, but here we are. We've had it, and particularly within the last perhaps 5 or so minutes, the chances are coming at both ends, and it looks to me like what we're seeing is that the teams are determined, getting more and more determined to score a goal. And of course, when you start pushing more players forward, you leave a little more opportunity in your own defense for the other team to nip in there.
Dieter Ferner had some words of advice for his fullbacks on that last shot by Romero. He didn't get the kind of help he thought he should get. Now here's Charlie Ficus, wearing number 9, deflected by Jeff Durgan.
Well, Karl-Heinz Granitza was offside. The Cosmos, in fact, I think played him offside that time. As the ball came through, they moved upfield.
We've had the threat of rain all day long. It did rain last night here in Toronto, and the field this morning was quite wet. It's noticeably damp in spots, but I don't think that's affected play much, Paul.
As Houston with a brilliant interception again. No, I don't think it has, because when this sort of turf gets wet, you can see great splashes and sprays, and it's like a fountain when the ball bounces. We've seen none of that.
Marhedic at midfield tries to get by Naiskins. There's Houston into the corner for Marhedic. I think it's going to be too far for even Pato. It is. Not even his speed could get him there. Pato Marhedic. Cosmos, Bob Yarushi. That may be a little too wild, and Mathieu will take it for Chicago.
Yeah, well, there's a couple of very wild kicks, one after the other there. And of course, that, as I say, that's the sort of stuff. And the, well, there's another one that's not too.
Mathieu. Well, Mathieu, watch out. Offside.
I think Giorgio, the last thing Giorgio expected probably there was, of all people, Jeff Durgan to appear out of nowhere, and you can see the ball playing. Giorgio is running to get into position. Matthew decides that he's going to chest the ball down and then play it out, but he bounces much too high for him, and by the time it comes down, here comes Jeff Durgan. Well, we didn't see him come in there, but he came in and was able to play it. So it was, again, a slight error by Matthew there, and that's the sort of thing that sooner or later, at one end or the other, is going to lead to a score.
Matthew, over to Paul Hahn, number five. 6'2", 32-year-old West German. Oh, there's Naiskins throwing his body to the cause again.
Exactly, yeah. And
I saw him.
Hedick standing there. And
there's Seninho, and we have no score here in Toronto.
The 1980 Winter Olympics. Hockey team captain Michael Ruzioni helped clinch the gold for the U.S.
I'm Michael Ruzioni, the artist. Budweiser asked me to paint with these to help raise funds for America's Olympic athletes. Now you can own my painting and help our athletes train for 84. After all, there are a lot of Picassos. There's only one, Ruzioni.
Call 1-800-325-1488 for more information.
How good is Express Mail next day service from your post office?
A spare part overnight from St. Louis kept my factory from going kablooey.
This came from L.A. the very next day, and for overnight service, it's not much to pay.
Under a pound is under $10 anywhere we go from 3,000 post offices.
Overnight from the firm in Duluth, Express Mail works. Here's the proof.
When you need it overnight, we deliver.
Yeah, Marhedic standing there as Naiskins came thundering past him, looking as though he'd just been brushed by a Toronto trolley bus.
Derek Spaulding, and it's across the touchline, throw in Cosmos. Or is it Chicago? Steffenhagen will take it. Arno Steffenhagen looks for help, looks for Rudy Glenn, finds him. Eskandarian in the area. Now Arno, very fluent in about four languages. Born in Berlin, has lived here now with his wife and family.
Well, Bullion. Now, Bullion is a man who will take a long-distance shot. Not this time. Bogisevic will not.
Canaya, double-teamed. Out on the left side, it goes to Wegerle. He'll look for the center. There's the cross. And Canaya's up in the air. Not a lot on it.
No.
And it's across the end line. Goal kick, Chicago.
Simply too much attention from the Chicago Sting defenders on that. Not an easy ball to play for Giorgio Canaya.
Didier Ferner with the distribution out to Ingo Peter. Peter across the midfield line, looks for Pato Marhedic, lays it off for Marhedic. Romero lets him go, and Naiskins picks him up. That's his shadow. And Johan with the tackle, and a foul is called on Naiskins.
In fact, I think the foul was almost after the tackle. This is a problem with players like Naiskins, and to some extent Jeff Durgan, who seem to want to tackle by throwing themselves on the ground all the time, is that they're going to get hooked up with the player even after they've kicked the ball away, and I think that's what happened there.
Now, here's Granica from 34 and a half yards out. He has taken one and passed
and a
over.
Half. You got that?
I can see that 18-inch spread there. Here's the kick, and it'll be too far and wide right.
Trying, in fact, with his left foot to hook it into that top left-hand corner, but it hooked well wide and indeed high.
Carl Hines has, for the most part, been shadowed successfully by Jeff Durgan tonight. And in contrast, we go back, concurrent with that, we go back to the beginning of the show. Franz Mathieu has shut down Canaya, though Canaya had a tremendous scissors kick that almost went in. Here are the Cosmos on the far side. We are still scoreless in Toronto. Foul called by Dante Maglio. And it'll be a Cosmos free kick from the left corner. Bogisevic to Yerushi. Up in the air for Canaya, but Ferner gets there first.
Again, it looks like an opportunity, but again, the Chicago defenders all there, all around the ball, all jumping. Very difficult for a forward to get off a clean header under those circumstances.
Shots thus far in the game. The Sting have taken 8, and the Cosmos have taken 11. At midfield, here's Romero. 3-on-2 break if he can hurry. Romero, left side for Giorgio. And it's across the end line. It'll come back Chicago's way.
Romero.
For
Fortunately, the man who owns this business is covered by Continental Insurance.
Players is fluent in three or four languages. French among them, of course. And back into Dieter Ferner. I like the job he's done on Giorgio so far tonight.
Yes, he's done an excellent job on him so far. Now, I'm not saying anything to sort of, this
right.
is not pro Cosmos. What I'm hoping is that Mathieu will start going up on attack and we'll leave Giorgio a little more room, just as I would like to see at the other end, a little more attacking from the back players of the Cosmos and a little more room left to the Chicago attackers.
Eskandarian at midfield, through to Romero. Canaya gets it, pushes it back
very
to Romero.
Quickly. That was beautifully read by Mathieu, because he came for that ball before Canaglia had made the pass, so he was able to intercept it.
Great example of his quickness. Here's Canaglia. This time he's got Ficus on him.
Yeah, he did very well, Canaglia. That's not the sort of thing he's noted for.
Giorgio, nice touch. Romero, left side, Bouillon. And now the battle continues and it's cleared.
And again, the man who saved that, the man who put in the despairing tackle and got the ball, was Dave Hewson.
Granitza has it now. There's Marhedic. And it's Arno Steffenhagen, marked by Eskandarian. Steffenhagen, one-on-one with no help. And it's through, kicked and deflected. It'll be a corner kick. Chicago, and Granitza will take it on the far side.
And these have been dangerous so far. The Cosmos have been in some difficulty as a result of two or three of these corner kicks. And I think one of the reasons is that the way in which they're taken by... this, of course, with his left foot is going to be an inswinger. I'm just going to say they're outswingers. This one's going to be an inswinger. This will swing in towards the goalkeeper.
Way out. And Bouillon belts Ficus from behind. There is no foul called. Cosmos control. Mathieu will go over, let it go for Paul Hahn, and here comes Chicago again.
Well, oops. Again, lacks defending there, because Hahn had plenty of time to play that ball, which means, of course, in turn, that the defenders had plenty of time to watch what he was doing, and yet they allowed Rudy Glenn to get in the middle of them there, and again, Rudy Glenn had been a foot taller, or the ball had been a foot lower. He must have had a good header on goal.
Here's the ball cleared on the near sideline. It'll be a throw-in for the Cosmos to be taken by Sininho. Sininho, hey, let us have the ball back. Excuse me, Naiskens will take the throw-in instead. Right side for Romero. Ingo Peter goes back, and he'll let it go. And that'll be a goal kick, Chicago, with no score in the match. Just under 12 minutes remaining in the match. Chicago and New York scoreless. Dieter Ferner, goalkeeper. Looks for Steffenhagen, Mathieu for Chicago. And here comes Steve Wegerle. Wegerle pushing it toward the end line. Can he get there and save it?
Too
no.
Far, yeah.
Yep.
All he'd succeeded in doing was scaring the life out of the photographers.
He's a likable young South African, Wegerle. Had a great career at Tampa Bay, then went to Los Angeles before coming here.
Yeah, well, because he never actually played for
right.
Los Angeles. He didn't want to go to Los Angeles at all.
Quick stop.
Yeah, he was there about 10 minutes, I think.
Romero. Canaya. Mathieu with a takedown. Canaya might be hurting a little bit. Giorgio gets up, and Mathieu slaps him on the back.
Yes, that was... Well, now, who is Giorgio screaming at? The referee?
I'm not sure.
Claiming a penalty?
I think so.
It was certainly a pretty solid-looking tackle from Mathieu. It didn't look like an illegal one.
Here comes Chicago. Just under 11 minutes to go in the match. No score. Cosmos in the sting. Chicago has not had a winner in professional sports in 63, when the Bears won the NFL title. Yeah, let's take a look at that again, Paul.
Yeah, we'll see what this foul was all about. You can see Mathieu gets a bit of the ball first time. Now, is that what he's complaining about? Because, in fact, Mathieu certainly got the ball solidly, and the general feeling, I think, particularly of calls in or around the penalty area, is that if you play the ball, you're going to be very lucky to get a call against you. Very unlucky to get a call against you.
There's a good look at Derek Spalding. And we have no score. Ferner out to make the save on the long cross. And here's a foul called on Jeff Durgan.
Jeff Durgan doesn't agree with. He's going to argue with the referee about that, which is stupid. Funnily enough, that looked like a better call than the one at the end of the first half, which he didn't argue about, which I thought was suspect. But when two players go for the ball like that, if one of them doesn't jump, particularly the first one, and sort of bends over, there's a tremendous risk of the second player overbalancing over the top of that player and falling very heavily.
The peripatetic Dave Hewson. He's been all over the place.
Well, he's been... peripatetic Dave Hewson has been intercepted by the ubiquitous Johan Neeskens.
I knew you'd counter. I knew you had.
I don't know what either of the words mean, but they sound delicious.
Polysyllabic Paul Gardner. Here's Romero. Nice tackle by Paul Hahn. He's been quite solid at that back line tonight.
He is a good-looking player back there. He really is.
Hewson again. Marhedic. Forward to Stefan Hagen. Loosely played. Now Marhedic gets it back. He's been kind of quiet for the most part tonight, except one shot early on in the match. Romero, who is the freshest of the players on the field.
We got a 4-on-3 here at the moment.
Left side to Wegerle. Seninho and Canaya calling for the ball on the right side. There's the cross and Mathieu again. And Chicago has it.
Canaya is annoyed again. This time, I really don't know what for, because it seemed to me that cross, it should have been longer, of course. It should have gone over Mathieu, but that's the sort of thing that you really can't pinpoint those things.
Paul Hahn. Left side it comes. Charlie Ficus. Indiana University graduate. And here's Rudy Glenn, also from Indiana University. Inside to Granitza. Watch it. Shot! Oh. Deflected.
Well, Granitza did very well on that, because I think he had a good place to claim that he was being held by Durgan as he turned with that ball. And you can see the instant he turned, the instant he could get his head round and see the goal, the left foot flashed and the ball just rocketed towards Birkenmeyer. And once again, the Cosmos have to thank Birkenmeyer, because that game was bang on target. And he'll take the corner kick himself. This will be an outswinger with his trusty left foot.
It will come with 7:40 remaining in regulation play of a scoreless game. The Cosmos and the Sting. Granitza with the corner. He'll play it shallow. Here's Spalding. And a very casual and weak shot by Spalding.
We'll take a look. This is the turn. You can see Durgan is doing everything he can. That left foot shot. Birkenmeyer on the left of the screen almost knocked on his back by it.
Here's the throw in by Yerushi. It goes to Bogisevic. Back to Bogisevic from Yerushi. And now still controlled. There's a bump on the ball, and that ought to be a foul called on
Rudy Glenn again, who's, as the expression is in England, putting it about a bit. He's a bit clumsy on his tackles, as Reisbergen will tell you.
Yerushi, whoops.
Well, that's not the best shot Bob Yerushi ever took, for sure. In front of his hometown crowd, too.
He will not want that included in the Cosmos highlight.
Well, Yerushi knows how to live with these things. Twice this season, he put through his own goal. And the second one was an absolute beauty, an absolute flashing header, which roared past Birkenmeyer. Look at that for a pass.
On the right side, here come the Sting. There's the center. Whoa, watch out! Birkenmeyer's down.
I'm afraid there was a little misunderstanding, to put it as charitably as possible, between Birkenmeyer and Durgan there. Birkenmeyer did not handle that ball well, and Durgan decided he got to jump in, and Romero heading out of his own goal area there.
When in trouble, call on everybody, huh?
Mm-hmm. Well,
here come the Cosmos.
We have Durgan on attack, but he's having a little trouble with the ball.
Seninho has it now. Seninho with Spalding marking him. Heads to his left. Passes over to Romero. Romero looks for Seninho, headed out by the Cosmos' Derek Spalding. Ingo Peter at midfield, left side. Here come the Sting.
And again, this is what we're seeing later in the game here, as there's gaps in the defense here, great spaces in the defense.
Marhedic.
They're allowing Marhedic to get through here, and he's going to get through.
Marhedic.
Here comes Neeskens.
Look out. Deflected header by Bogisevic that cleared it out of danger.
Well, again, Marhedic, he only needs to do that once or twice during the game. And he just got himself past three players there and got into a good position for a cross, and it was a good cross, but well headed out by Bogey.
Here's Seninho, taken away from the ball by Hahn. A foul is called, and it'll be a free kick, Cosmos.
Now there's some bumping. Seninho is going after Hahn.
Maglio says, get back.
No. In fact, Seninho obviously was fouled by Hahn right there, right? There's a kick there. But then Seninho, after the whistle had gone, fouled Hahn, and Hahn, as he was running back, bumped Seninho, and so on and so on and so on.
Romero, headed out by Mathieu.
Not a very good header, that.
We are in Toronto, and we are still scoreless.
American cars used to be fat. Now they're...
Steve Wegerle with a throw-in for the Cosmos on the far side. 4.5 remaining in the match. The center, Canaglia. It'll bounce once, and Spalding tries to keep his hands away from the ball. Wouldn't that be an inadvertent handball?
Oh, I would. It certainly would.
Gee, Monday Christmas.
That seems to have been the story. There's Giorgio wondering exactly when he's going to get a ball where it's exactly where he wants it. But, I mean, it's been, been the same for... you'll see this is just too high. He gets up. But, look, it bounces off his head. He can't really get anything on it at all. It's not quite where he wanted it. And it's been the same at the other end for Granica and Stefan Hagen. The ball is never quite where they want it.
Eskandarian with Romero in front and Sonino on the right wing. Sonino with the ball now. He'll try and head for the end line. Does inside the penalty box. There's the attempted cross down low, and it's deflected. And this will be only the second corner kick for the Cosmos tonight.
Again, that's only, no, I think it's the third.
Thank you, pardon.
You're evidently discounting the one that Wegerle practically deposited in the parking lot in the first half.
Well, it shouldn't count.
With Sonino winning that corner, only a player with the speed of Sonino could push the ball past the defender and catch up with it before it went over the goal line. Bogey.
Bogisevic. Cleared momentarily by Chicago, now cleared for good. Here comes Stefan Hagen. Arno with the beard flowing and the locks flying. Got Mathieu in front. Lays it off for Mathieu, the give and go. Back to Stefan Hagen. He pushes forward and it's too far for Marchetti.
Now that really was a surprising mistake by Stefan Hagen because he worked a good give and go with Mathieu. Mathieu's return pass was a little bit too far ahead of him, and Stefan Hagen reached for it and pushed it much too hard. I would have thought a player of Stefan Hagen's skill could have played that ball more softly, and certainly Marchetic was waiting for it.
Here's Steve Wegerle. We've got 2:56 remaining in the game. Regulation time. Back to play. Over the head of Arno Stefan Hagen from Granica. And the clock unraveling with 2:40 remaining in the match. No score. Chicago and New York. Few of the 36,900 here would have thought it. Bogisevic has the ball. Canaglia waits for it. So does Paul Hahn. Now Canaglia and Mathieu battle for it. And it's cleared out by the Chicago Sting. Charlie Ficus has it on his right foot. He'll lay it off for Marchetic, who heads backwards. 2:20 remaining in the match in regulation time. We will go to sudden death if there's no score at the end of regulation, or if it's tied at the end of regulation. Here comes Chicago. 2:05 to go in regulation time. Charlie Ficus, he's got some space with Yarushi laying back. Now Yarushi comes forward. Granica. Granica with the right foot. Nope, he'll not take it. Back toward midfield. There'll be a race for the ball, which Canaglia will win with the chest trap for Giorgio, but now it's taken away. Rudy Glenn deftly, delicately tossed over to Charlie Ficus. 1:45 to go. Ingo Peter through to Granica, lays it off to Marchetic. Marchetic has to run to catch it. Naiskens follows him. Here comes Pato. Oh, nice move around Naiskens. On the ground, it's deflected and cleared out by Wegerle. Lovely touch by Marchetic.
Beautiful touch, but we've been complimenting Hahn all night, but I think Sonino has given that ball away. Hahn made a bad mistake, Sonino's made another one, and this is the sort of thing, of course, that brings excitement to the game.
There's the ball. Oh, just a bit too far
for Stefan Hagen. Yes. Well, in the last 2 minutes, I think we've seen more opportunities, potential opportunities, than we've seen in the whole of the second half.
1 minute to go in regulation time. That is the unofficial time, of course, because the only official clock is kept by the referee down on the field. And we may have injury time when the clock is expired, so we should say approximately 50 seconds remaining. There's Romero, 40 seconds to go. Across the far sideline, it'll be Chicago's for perhaps one last thrust in regulation time. Yarushi heads it back. Sonino. Spalding marks him. And they're looking downfield for Giorgio. Mathieu right in front. Boy, perfect position.
He'd better be on perfect position because there was nobody else back there to support him if he'd missed that ball.
And that's it. That's it. Regulation time has expired here in Toronto with the Chicago Sting and the Cosmos of New York scoreless. And Paul, we go to sudden death.
Well, sudden death, overtime, I mean, that really is the last thing one would have expected, particularly in a nothing-nothing situation. If this had been a 3-3 tie, I would have thought, yes, possible, but nothing-nothing? I don't know.
Well, first team to score wins it. And if they don't score in 15 minutes, we go to the shootout. We'll be back with sudden death right after this. Back in...